Hello, and thank you for joining us for the Pharmacy Cannabis Lecture Series. Each session is designed to deliver an in-depth dose of cannabis education. My name is Candace Hawes, and I want to thank all of our viewers and all of our customers from Bud and Bloom, from the Pottery, and from the Pharmacy Santa Barbara in Berkeley for joining us today. In this session, we will discuss the history of cannabis concentrates. Cannabis concentrates have been used by humans for thousands of years. Our special guest speaker today is Frenchie Cannoli, who's a world-renowned hash maker and who will lead us down a historical tour of the evolution of cannabis concentrates. Frenchie Cannoli is a California-based teacher, consultant, artisan, and activist dedicated to the production and appreciation of traditional cannabis concentrates. For over 40 years, he has dedicated his life to the art of creating and educating consumers on the traditional hashish. Frenchie grew up in Nice, France, but left home as early as he could, inspired by the promise of exotic adventure and by the imported hash common in late 60s Europe. He lived nomadically for over 20 years, staying with traditional producers and learning techniques handed down over generations. This took him to Morocco, Mexico, Nepal, Pakistan, and later India, where he spent 8 growing seasons living in caves and harvesting cannabis resin with the Pavati Valley cultivators. Eventually, he settled his family in California, where early medical access laws gave him the ability to go into the light and not have to hide his life's work and be able to produce legal cannabis concentrates. Frenchie celebrates the terrier, or the taste of the place. His brand proudly sources his flower from the flower for his concentrates from the farmers in the Emerald Triangle and beyond, where the farmers produce exceptional resin that is the source of his hashish quality. He's taken an open source approach to traditional methods. His Lost Art of the Hashishian seminars provide hands-on training for aspiring cannabis concentrate makers. And Frenchie freely shares the same techniques on YouTube and with his over 143,000 Instagram followers. He's likewise pushed for broader post-legalization education to develop hashish grading standards and is a prominent supporter of regional growing certifications for cannabis production. Inspired by the Appalachian origin rules like protecting the integrity of Bordeaux wines. He's also developing a feature-length documentary, Frenchie Dreams of Hashish, with his documentary filmmaker, Jake Remington, which showcases the challenges legalization has brought to the small California farmers. He also writes about the science of and global history of cannabis for publications including Extraction Magazine in the United States, Skunk Magazine in Canada, Weed World in England, and Dolce Vita in Italy. He has just finished the first draft of his book on cannabis concentrates, and you can find many of the articles on his website. I'm really excited to have Frenchie with us and to learn about the history of cannabis concentrates. So I'd like to turn it over to Frenchie.
Hi, everybody. So yeah, I cannot see you. It's a bit strange to talk to so many people without seeing them, but thank you for having me. And today, while we're going to talk about the history of concentrate, we're going to focus very much on the history of hashish. And hashish is part of the big family that is the concentrate family. So what is a concentrate? A cannabis concentrate is a product that is made from cannabis resin collected from the cannabis plant through a sieving or an extraction process, which are pretty different. And that defines anything from dry sieve trichon gland to the pure isolate. And this comes from what the plant kingdom produced as a defensive system against predator and harsh climatic condition. The word trichon comes from trichoma, the Greek, and it means air because it really looks like a hairy surface on the leaves of the plant. And in those trichon, the plant kingdom can produce secondary metabolites. The plant kingdom can produce 200,000 organic compounds, from the most deadly to the most beneficial. And the cannabis plant goes a little further. The cannabis plant produces compounds that can link to an endocannabinoid system that we have in our body that was born with the first life in a sea 1 billion years ago. 1 billion years later, almost 20 million years ago, the plant that produced those cannabinoids that was born. And a few million years later, the mammal came with the endocannabinoid system, triggered with those specific compounds. And the magic of it, cannabinoids are made of two organic compounds that are the most common in the plant kingdom, terpene and phenol. And those two compounds are actually toxic. Terpene very much so, and you can overdose on phenol. The cannabis plant can biosynthesize two toxic compounds and create 150 plus medicinal compounds, the cannabinoid. So the origin of all that, how did we figure that out? Well, it goes a very, very, very long time ago, even before the birth of the plant 28 million years ago or so in a high plateau of Tibet next to the lake Qinghai. I'm not sure of the pronunciation. Next to it, you had the biggest migration highway that has been going on for tens of millions of years. Animals coming from Africa and from the Americas and crossing over. And Siberia was the ultimate location and the high point of that migration. So the plant was born next to the best mean for a seed plant to be dispersed. But at the same time, because the cannabis plant is an evolution of the humulus, Hops family, and the Hops family come from pretty tropical, humid territory. And when it reached the limit of its territory, the high plateau of Tibet, the evolution became cannabis. And cannabis not only had the mean to move with all the mammals that eat plants toward Europe, but genetically speaking, it was made to live in dry grassland condition. So that there is proof that the plant was literally 6 million years ago in Europe, which means that the plant was on the shore of the Mediterranean Sea in the Fertile Crescent, the richest land on Earth, for 4 million years before Homo erectus moved from Africa to the Eurasian continent through the Levantine corridor, that Israel, Lebanon, Egypt corridor to enter the Eurasian continent. So imagine 4 million years of natural dispersal in the richest land on Earth. How hard would it be for a master forager to discover a plant when you have so hard a time to hide it in the 21st century? Our ancestor, you have to imagine that Homo erectus took a minute to move from South Africa to the Eurasian continent. And they were barehanded, naked, with nothing but what nature can give them to survive. They did survive 1.5 million years and inhabited the continent from Spain to Philippines. And they were 2.1 million years ago, very close to the birthplace of cannabis. Those people, the main food source that is reliable is seeds and grain because they pack a lot of nutrition, they have a longer-term shelf life, and they're light. So the main interest for our ancestors to have anything to do with the plant would be to try to get the seeds. And with a cannabis plant, when you touch the seeds, you get sticky finger. And that stickiness on your finger, it's an aromatic resin that is very appealing. And those people, any new plant, everything is survival. That means that everything counts. And there is a good chance that they would have tested that resin even maybe before eating the seeds, definitely before trying to cut the plant with a sharp stone to bring it to camp to dry. So how much of a leap it is to go from sticky finger to sticky hand? I don't think that very much. This is the first concentrate ever, live resin. Live resin is not BHO. Live resin is the first resin that stick on that ancestor. And it's still something that is done today on the planet in a certain tropical country. So, ancient history have a lot about cannabis. The oldest written form was in Assyria. They already talk about cannabis. Then the second biggest civilization, Egypt, in the oldest medicinal text, there is cannabis. China, the same. So the three oldest cultures we are really respectful of the plant to have the name mentioned in their oldest scripture, literally. Then you have ancient cannabis culture, Persia, with Zarathustra, the Aroma drink, and it's still only cannabis plant, and it's very mysterious. We don't really know what was the aroma. It's very much connected to the Indian soma because the culture comes from the same origin. And the soma has been seen as mushroom, opium, cannabis. There is a lot of mystery behind. But there is a lot of relation with the god Shiva, who is totally with the god of cannabis resin and the cannabis plant. And so the plant goes pretty far back in time, as far as ancient cannabis culture goes. With India, it's 5,000 years old, the oldest Veda script. And then you have the pastoralist culture. For the moment, we have talked only about the first sedentary culture, civilization. Now we're talking about the other side of the continent, the northern part of the continent. There is a line. And the northern part of the continent are serious stoners. The oldest solid evidence of the use of cannabis by pastoralist culture, it's the Yamnaya, and it's 5,000 years old. Those people moved over the world grassland, and the following civilization was the Scythian, hardcore stoners too. There is a lot of misinformation about them, but definitely hardcore stoners. And then the oldest hard, solid evidence, cannabis, a stash of a shaman, 2,500 years old, in a desert of Mongolia. This is the oldest solid evidence of the use of psychoactive cannabis. Then, on the other side of the planet, we find a 3,000 years old first evidence of the use of cannabis resin as an incense. Because it's an aromatic resin, it had to be, but there were nothing about it. There is nothing about cannabis resin ever before the 9th century, when the first things you have on your finger when you deal with the plant, it's cannabis resin. So it was pretty weird. And last year, the end of last year, they finally analyzed the residues that were on those two altars. On the highest one, they were burning frankincense. They have all the compounds, that the terpene compounds that are part of frankincense. And on the other one, they have cannabinoid, but there is no plant material with it, only cow dung, which means that they were actually burning cannabis resin. They were actually hot boxing, because this temple is 3,000 years old, Judaite temple. It's the holy of the holy in a fortress. And only the holiest people, I guess, can enter it. And they were like hot boxing hardcore. And that's the first evidence of actually inhaling cannabis resin smoke. So if you look at the map, you have the triangle, it's the birthplace of cannabis. Then you have those four circles in the neighborhood are four places where cannabis flowers have been found, but like solid evidence. The one higher up, like in the Altai Mountain, the dude had 13 flowers over his chest, full flower. On the two next to each other, one was a shaman and the other one was some cannabis plant also. And the third one, it's brasero to actually burn the flower with residue of cannabinoid inside. So this part is flower. On the other side of the planet, you have cannabis resin, hashish, or charas. And now if you look at the producing country, you have the Himalaya, you have Afghanistan, the Middle East, Lebanon, that whole place where the cannabis has been dispersing for millions of years. India, it's a bit different. Actually, India, the plant arrived in India only 32,000 years ago. I mean, only, yeah. But compared to 6 million years in Europe and 1.2 in Eastern China, it's kind of late. And it has been certainly brought by humanity migrating. In India, it's the only place where you actually collect the live resin on your hand. It's a way to collect cannabis resin, mostly because it's a very tropical country. It's pretty easy to collect. Most of the plants are like that. You cut the fan leaf with your fingertip and you just caress the flower. The harder you caress, the more contaminant you create. It's the same. And if you caress too hard, you break the plant. You have water and chlorophyll on your hand. It doesn't stick anymore. Or you have to get hard and you get a lot of stuff. So it's really like a very gentle touch is the best. And like you say, it's really practice today. In the 80s, we could go and rent the whole field like that. And it's yours to do. But to be able to stay there for months, you live in cave, you have to bring everything. It's 2 days walk from the closest road. I mean, it's remote. But you get stuff like that. So what's a little tricky, it's sticking the resin on your hand, it's pretty easy. You caress the first time, and already you look at your hand, it shines really in the sun, and it's super sticky. And then plant after plant, caress after caress, it layers until, and it goes from transparent to light amber, to dark amber, to dark reddish, and to really dark when your layer is thick enough. Once you have enough, you take the sum of one hand, you pick up the thickest part on your other hand, you press, you twist, you snap. And you have that white part that come out. So you here on the left bottom, you have a guy full hand. On the bottom right, you have a guy who took everything from one hand. You can see the ash on his thumb, on the other hand. And his hand, you see how nice and white it is, except for the first finger, it's not totally finished. You clean up your hand really well. It's like it snapped out really, really good. Then the trick is to be able to pass what you have on your thumb on the other hand so that you can clean your other hand, like the top right. Okay? Once it's done, you stick it into between two heavy sheets of plastic, or you roll a finger, you pack it, and you start again. And there is nothing else you can do during the day because you're sticking. So like even smoking, you better prep everything, have it ready in a hat. You can't even make a chillum. You don't touch nothing for hours. It's long day work. And charas look like that. It has that texture, almost like a caviar, grainy texture. You have little piece of green. It's not super clean, but it's a rough methodology to pick up stuff. However, it can become really clean. That's what we call jungle. Jungle, it's rubbing plants that have been growing in those mountains for 30,000 years. It was crazy amazing to do wild plants. But I didn't know that they had been growing there for 30,000 years plus. Now it would be even more of an experience, I imagine, knowing that. And it can become really clean, really clean. This is done at the end of the season. When you start to have a lot of dry parts in a plant, and those dry parts are really, really hard to get off your hand. The green ones are pretty easy. The dry parts are almost impossible, but this is cream coming from a place that is known worldwide for its quality, Malana. It's a little village in a very remote valley in the middle of nowhere in the Himalaya. And it can become as clean as that. That's hand rub resin. And this is the first ever concentrate. So now, how do you go from doing this to actually collecting dry resin gland that you cannot see, and then separating them from contaminants, then pressing them with the source of it so you can actually activate the cannabinoid? So how do you start? You start by drying the plant if you want to collect the seeds, for sure. Those people have been collecting seeds and grain for a few hundred thousand years from South Africa to Eurasia. That's the way to do it. You don't collect seed on a live plant. You may try it, but you don't collect it. And the only relation point there is to truly, it's you're going to have something sticky on your finger when you break the flower to collect the seeds. Okay? And when you do that, normally it's done over a type of basketry. that is used to separate chaff from grain. This basketry must be hundreds of thousands of years old. The concept of it, it's still used in nomadic tribes all over the planet. So when you break your flower, you have sticky finger and you have a cloud of dust falling. How can you connect that cloud of dust to what's sticky in your hand? I mean, it's not really evident. Doesn't matter how they figure it out. I mean, the relation those people had with the plant kingdom was pretty different than we have today. Those people were talking to plant. A plant was a spirit. A plant was a living organism that was given respect because that plant had 500 million years of evolution over it. You know what I mean? It's like we are just pollinators if you think of it a little tiny bit. So their understanding, the approach to that, I don't think we can figure it out because they could talk to plants. We don't anymore. But beyond that understanding, you need a structure because you come into processing. So you need a certain level of agriculture. You don't need full-blown agriculture. 9,000 years before the birth of agriculture, very close to where the ash was born, the oldest semi-nomadic tribe that was building a house with a stone frame and were making flatbread and beer didn't need agriculture to do that. They had just come back to the same place for so long and favored the same plant for so long that you have a field of it, or it became denser and denser and denser because that's the plant you leave the seed there, quoi, basically. In a refuse of humanity, that's how agriculture literally was born. And then you need to be able to dry and store. Even it's like, before leaving the winter territory we throw seeds in the spring and come back in autumn, you harvest, they're going to stay in that cave. They have the means to dry the plant and even cure it. That's the second step that is necessary. Because if you start to make ash, seeding, it's going to be bigger quantities. That's the name of the game. You don't produce that much by rubbing between your hands. And then you need the tool. So how did they get the tool? The tool, the first solid evidence of a thread, of a three-part thread together to make the thread stronger, is 50,000 years old, and the Neanderthal were making it. The oldest woven thread known is 28,000 years and come from Eastern Europe. And then you have the birth, the next to the birth of agriculture in China, you have the oldest evidence of silk is 8,500 years old of silk production. And you pass the desert, you arrive in Pakistan, the birth of cotton is 7,000 years ago. And in a fertile crescent, it's the end of what we know today as the Silk Road, that is just what we know today, that was the main migratory route for tens of millions of years of all the animals and most plants on the continent. So hashish, as you can see, looks very, very, very different from Charas. And everything about it is different. The experience, the taste, the texture is like it's not the same product at all. It's very much two different concentrates. You have a live resin collected on your hand and resin that has been collected in trichon gland that has been dried and cured, which totally changed the terpene profile and a lot of property of the product at the same time. Terpene play a huge role in how we experience when we smoke. So this was Moroccan, not totally fully pressed. You can press it like that. Middle is pretty close to it. Otherwise, here on the plastic, you can see this is some nice melty stuff. This is some Pakistani, pretty high quality also. This is Afghan. And they add a lot of stamp in a time, but it's mostly marketing. This come from country where it's totally illegal. Even in India, where Shivais can smoke, you can buy flour, opium, and bong in a government shop, while it's still illegal to smoke hash. Every producing country, it's illegal. So you're not going to put a stamp to advertise your place. You know what I mean? But it looks really good. So now, hashish, like charas, is a second concentrate that is totally, the quality is totally defined by the cleanliness of the resin. Not so much by the maturity of the gland. I think because it's land raised, those people have been doing that in those places for hundreds of generations. So it's like it's a very simple, basic knowledge that is passed down generation after generation and fine-tuned through those generations. So the moment of harvest, they do know. The principles of dry sieving are important because I do ice water sieving. And everything I do with water is based on this principle. I don't do an extraction because a trichon gland, like I showed you earlier, is a protuberance. A protuberance cannot be extracted. An extraction, you need to take an object, a product from a mass, like to give you a good example, you extract gold from a mountain, but you pan it from a river. You extract a tooth, you extract many things, but there is always a matrix that is taken from. Okay? This is not. This is not only trichome are excroissance, protuberance are not part of the main morphology of the plant, it's just a defensive system. But I take only the gland that is attached to the stalk, okay? That's definitely not an extraction, it's a separation. And the principle of dry sieving are based on two separations. What is one that is done by the agitation? You break, through agitation, you break the gland from the stalk. And the second separation, it's through the perforation of my tool, the sieve. And those two processes are part of a methodology that you cannot separate. The more action, the more force you put into your agitation, the more contaminant you're going to create because you work with dry material. So every time You sieve, your first sieving is going to be super light. You finish your pile, you collect the resin, you take back the pile, and your second agitation is going to be a little stronger, and so on and so on and so on until you tell yourself, okay, that's it, I'm good. That's the basic. Now, when you bring water into the story, it changes a lot, because water rehydrates the brittle material, and that brittle material, when it's rehydrated, it's supple, and so you cannot create contaminants, except if you make a major mistake, mostly too much sea, too much material, and too much ice, because the ice has the power to grind your supple material and create small contaminants. But the beauty of ice water sieving is that you can actually separate the two processes. Now I can create an agitation chamber to only agitate, and my bag are my sieving tool. It's not just a bag where you push the resin in the middle and you collect with a spoon. That's the second half of the whole methodology that you can fine tune. You can do so much better. That is unreal. And then you can reach a level of cleanliness that is really hard to equal with such ease. And we owe that to Mila. Actually, she's the one who took a machine that was pretty bombass. The guy who made that first ice water machine is a family from Mendocino, from Laytonville. But the system was, there were no separation of the processes. The agitation and the separation were happening at the same time in the same chamber. So that if you have never sieved dry sieve in your life, it's hard to understand. For me, it was such a revelation when I finally, after 20, 40 years, I don't know, of dry sieving, somebody give me the next evolution of a game that is tens of thousands of years old. Like, this is something else. That's why it's so important to understand that it's sieving that we're doing, because it's such an amazing evolution. It's such an old, old game that I've seen only evolution in the tool made, like the quality of the sieve and stuff, but not on the methodology itself. It's crazy. And it gives me the ability to do live resin if I want. I can bring my machine straight up in the field or on the farm and cut the plant and put them directly in my machine. The only thing is when I do that, the plant, when you cut it, it bleeds. The chlorophyll in the body of the plant is contained in a vein-like system. Okay? So you cut, it bleeds. It's going to be just a tiny bit. Your first wash, I do 8 wash. And every time it bleeds a tiny bit more. But you can get it out. However, it's a lot of work and a lot of water. And I'm very much constrained by strain and farm, because my window of opportunity is small, harvest time. You know what I mean? So there is so much I can do. And as much as I was totally against frozen, because when you freeze a plant that is made of 80% of water, the ice has 10% more of a mass. That means that you literally explode at the cellular level the plant from the inside out. And if the inside melts, the green you get, you cannot get rid of it. And I had bad experience in wrong condition. So I was telling everybody, this is not it. Until I brought my machine at the farm and I was spinning at night. I work at night to do at harvest time most of the time. And I was still all pumped up in the morning, and the guy was freezing material, a bunch of it. So I told him, I said, look, man, I'm ready for the day. Let me try some. And when I tried it with my stainless steel double jacket it doesn't melt before I finish my run. That means that the scar is cauterized by the ice. And I have an advantage that is huge But you need to work in super cold condition, and not only your water, but the room, the tool, everything to be able to manipulate it. The main characteristic of resin, it's sticky. We use cold so that we can manipulate a gland that is sticky and separate it through the perforation of a tool. Everything has to be really cold so that you can maximize the process. If it's warm, it's going to stick all over. So now I have a new opportunity. I can do live resin all year long. I mean, it's hard to call it still live resin, but it is. It's protected. And I can get it from many farms. My only limit are technical, how much of a storage I have and how much frigorific truck I can send left and right, basically. It's huge for a ash maker, halala. And then I can also do dried and cured. And cured is keyword here, because if you give me a plant that is just dried, guess what? There is still chlorophyll in it, like a lot. And it bleeds in my machine, a lot. And I cannot get it out. I cannot. As much as live resin I can, dry I cannot. And then the closer I get to the 3 months window of curing, the less green it becomes. Then there is a stage where I can even start cleaning the green, it disappears. And then the chlorophyll has totally transformed in sugar and my water is gold. That's why cured is a key word. And just to mention it, to see how tradition are on point, there is no producing country that collects their resin gland before 3-9 months cure, except in Afghanistan, and they cure the resin in goat skin underground for 6 months before taking it out and pressing and aging. So it's like curing, it's you do magic. You do the isomer, the polymer of the terpene bound, there is a polymerization. You have a different terpene profile that is created, that is different from the live resin, from the live plant, and from the just dry plant. And sometimes it's crazy amazing. Aficionado has a plant Pinot Noir. The live resin is like a field of flower, but not perfumey, with lavender in it. I come from south of France. I love my lavender, but the cured flower give me an ash that tastes and smell like milk chocolate. Okay? So there is, again, you cannot compare live and dried and cured. It's like comparing charas and hashish. It's two different concentrates. Okay? This is what we collect. But when I collect that, I collect it whole. I collect it whole and I press it into a mass. That means that in hashish, you have not only the resin, but the matrix that created everything inside that mass. And when you do that, you have ice water hashish. And I call it ice water hashish to define mostly the methodology to make it, because this is traditional ash. I just use the latest technology to collect my resin gland. But once my gland are dried, well, it's the same than if I had collected them dry, or pretty much so. Okay? So it's very for any traditional ash country. If I don't tell them that I did that, I collected that with ice water, they wouldn't know, they don't really care. It's like it's a resin. That all there is, doesn't matter how you collect it, it's the qualities that talk to them, because they don't have that next tech, cutting edge stuff in their minds, but they can appreciate the end product. You know what I mean? The difference between hashish and other concentrate, it's any other concentrate, you leave behind the matrix that created the resin. And this is leaving behind a huge part of the equation. So to give you an example of experience, if you smoke the ash, it's like a warm blanket in front of a fireplace on a bare rug, and like a cozy feeling that lasts, like that bubble of well-beingness, no rush, like you squeeze that and you smoke it, it bangs you, it's super speedy and it's short. Okay? It's very much like eating grape and drinking the juice of a grape. It's not the same. And as much as you can make mini alcohol from the juice of a grape, up to 90.9% pure, and every one of those alcohol could be magnificent, you will not be able to do wine if you don't have that matrix that created the juice and the sugar. So it's like, I have nothing against extraction solvent and non-solvent. I have a lot of respect actually for it because I come from the perfume industry. And even if I don't know the text, I have a lot of respect for the perfume industry and the correlation with the butane extraction and CO2 extraction and all the extraction we use. But we have to understand that this is another family into the concentrate main family. We enter new territory with limitless possibility, literally. So you have first non-solvent, it's rosin press, and you can do, no, it's not only the simple squishing, because you can do literally pure THCA. If you do pure THCA, I give you high CBDA plant. Well, you're going to give me pure CBDA because you know the temperature. You know what I mean? It's all question of temperature and length of time. And if you have those values, you can manipulate and do stuff that the big pharma told us were impossible 50 years ago. Now with a squisher, with a rosin press, you can do it. It's crazy. And when you come into the solvent extraction, that's where it gets scary for the big pharma. Because any kid, you don't have to be a PhD. If you have $40,000-$50,000, and you know your stuff, you can do anything from shatter to pure isolate all day long. That's very scary for the big pharma because everybody technically could do it. It's everywhere. If you know where to look and you know which people to truck tech, it's possible to learn for many. So now it's that must be a very scary thought for the big pharma to see it going wild, literally. And voilà, that's a big overview of concentrate. I have a classification about it because it's very important for me so that people make a difference between a wall trichon head that has been pressed into a mass that contain the matrix that created it and the other concentrate that leave behind the matrix that created the resin. Et voilà, I'm not sure how long it took, but it should be 45.
This was great. Thank you so much, Frenchie. I think I have a couple questions. If anybody else has questions, please submit them to me. But I really appreciate and respect your dedication to the original forms of concentrates. I thought that was an amazing presentation. I really loved how you compared it to the modern methods and just even, you know, the comparison to, you know, the charas and the hash and stuff. It was a lot of great information for people that have been, you know, you know, making concentrates for millions or for a long time, or, you know, the new concentrate makers, even those that are just trying to learn about it. It was a lot of information, and I found it was really intriguing. I really loved your review of world history too, and I found that to be really interesting. So if anybody has any questions, go ahead and send them to me. I did have one question that came through, and someone was asking, what does the chlorophyll do to the concentrates if it's left in?
It gives a green color to the concentrate, and chlorophyll is not tasty. So to a level, you may not be able to define it, but to a level, it's a degradation of the overall quality of the resin. It's like most of the time, you don't really taste it. I had ash that were green that I had to put on the market because it tasted so great, but I knew I could have done better if I had waited for the plant material to cure longer.
Interesting. Somebody also asked, what is the matrix that you're referring to?
The matrix, it's, so when you take the juice from a fruit, everything that you leave behind is a matrix, the medium, what created the sugar and the juice. Everything that is created inside the resin gland, it's made by many components, many compounds. And this, when you take only the resin, you leave it behind. That's a big part of the equation. You cannot talk about full spectrum extract because you go beyond the entourage effect to a certain limit, because that matrix that creates everything is very much part of the entourage effect. Imagine that the plant literally can control the thickness of the membrane and how much resin it exudes. Like everything in that membrane is controlled to a level that is amazing, because everything that is there is toxic to the plant and it's to deal with the outside world. So everything is super important. The plant is very stingy. And they reuse everything. So every part, it's not just lipid or just that. It's a big deal because it makes stuff. And I want it all, but I'm making wine. I'm not going beyond that. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't compare with what I do. It's like, would you compare wine and whiskey? And between you guys that make different concentrates, do you compare whiskey and cognac and tequila? You know what I mean? It's like, we have so much diversity in what we do. We have so much craftsmanship, and we are bickering about our tech is better because this or that. It's like, no, how can we respect and acknowledge the diversity that the plant is giving us through all those different methodologies to create great products? It's like, come on, guys, we should be beyond my tech is better than the other. It's different. You can't compare.
Yeah. All right. And somebody else also asking, how long do you suggest for a cure?
Of the flower? Mm-hmm. 3 months minimum.
And what is the best time for harvest if you're going to use your crop for hash?
So the best time is the peak of the flowering cycle. And you have to understand that the peak of the flowering cycle is part of the main metabolism of the plant. Okay? It's defined by the main metabolism of the plant. And trichomes are not part of the main metabolism of the plant. It's a defensive system that the plant produce to deal with the outside world, okay? The coloration of trichome gland are pretty much determined by the amount of UV rays that they receive during their lifetime. And the size or the color of your trichome will never give you any clue on the main metabolism of your plant. So you're growing flower. You have to look at the flower. It's like somebody called me stupid, but it's true, the comparison is a little heavy, but when you grow tomato or when you grow any plant on any type of product on any plants that produce trichome, you don't look at the trichome to tell you if your tomato is ripe. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, it's stupid, but is it not stupid to not even understand that you're dealing with the main metabolism of the plant that define, on the other hand, the amount of resin that is formed inside the resin gland? Because if you harvest 2 weeks early, there is very, very little resin formed inside the resin gland. And the closer you come to your peak window, the fuller your resin gland are. And through the tech I use, I can tell you to the day how early or how late you have harvested your plant. But I'm not a farmer. I can tell you that after. The trichome gland is the bibliography of the life of the plant with the outside world. I can read that. But to read that, I need to collect it and to make ash out of it. Otherwise, everything is behind that membrane. I don't know how much there is inside. I cannot look inside. But I know for a fact that the peak cycle of the flowering defines the amount of resin that is formed inside.
Very interesting.
I'm not helpful, I know, but.
I have another question here. Do you foresee any major changes in the future of live resins that would be like another game changer akin to the ice water sieving that you talked about?
Oh, it is already a game changer. BHO has made work. It's a game changer. It's a little sad that they appropriated it because that was certainly done 4 million years ago, 2 million years ago. You know what I mean? But you have to understand also that you don't have a hash culture. You don't have a concentrate culture here in America. You had a hash culture in the 70s. Then you had no input from the outside world and you were growing your own for two generations. And a little ash left and right, but not much. And then BHO came. And that opened the door to people like Nikati, Matt Rice, and everything that was sieved was ice wax, solventless. It has the appeal, the look. You smoked it in the same tool, didn't leave too much residue, packed a lot more terpene in the good old days. You know what I mean? It was a fit in the door. And if you look at the progression, at the evolution of concentrate in the US this past 10 years, well, it's a BHO that is breaking ground and everybody is following. You know what I mean? It's like, and they have the tool to do magic. That's the ultimate tool to capture the most volatile terpene. You know what I mean? It's like, it's an amazing tool when it's in the right hand with the knowledge and dedication behind. Whew.
I have another question. If you were utilizing these skills in a small personal scale and the yield when dry sieving is not high, what would your next step be to create even a small amount of high quality hashish? So they're not getting much from dry sieving. What would the next step be?
But you will get as much with dry sieving, technically speaking, but not in the same level of cleanliness. So you have two ways, or you clean your dry sieve, or you do ice water. And making ice water can be pretty simple. You have the stuff in your kitchen.
Yeah.
Literally, except for the sieve material that are pretty important to separate the contaminant, the agitation part in water, pretty easy. To clean your dry sieve, you have two ways. You have static electricity, the 21st century tech, and a tech that was shown to me by Afghan friend in 1980 in India, where they had some resin, they took a big bowl, like they have a big metal bowl of water there. They pour water in it, not specifically ice cold, like not in New Delhi. And they sprayed all their tricon, their stuff over it. And they waited, 2 minutes, and scooped everything that was floating. And everything that was at the bottom, they dried it on the roof. And it was clean, pure clean, because then you, instead of, separating by size, you use weight. The plant contaminants are lighter than the fully formed resin gland, so it's easy to separate. They float or they are attracted to the materials that has the static electricity on it, basically.
Interesting. Well, thank you so much for sharing all your insight. I know we have more questions coming in, but we don't have any more time today, unfortunately, with Frenchie. This has been so wonderful. I've really enjoyed this webinar. Here's on the screen some information about how you can get, how you can send him questions, how you can follow him, how you can find out more information about all the articles that he's written. I really thank you guys for joining us today for this edition of the Pharmacy Cannabis Lecture Series. I want to thank our guest, Frenchie Cannoli and Kimberly, for helping to make this possible. I hope that we were able to share some information with everybody that will help become better informed cannabis consumers, and that this information will help you find relief. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you for having me.